So hello everyone and welcome to this new lecture of the machine learning course. So today the topic will be about logistic regression. So I think you all know about this method. It's really like one of the most basic and famous methods to do binary classification. It's quite old, you know, it dates back from the 40s, and even it would use a function called the logistic function. And if you look, you know, how old is a logistic function, it really dates back 1830. So it's something really old, but it is still widely used in practice. And, you know, and it's often used on top of neural networks. So you will see later in the course with neural networks, you will use your networks to learn some features. And on top of it, you will often do a classification step. And for this classification step, you will often use the logistic loss. So it's still really widely used, and it's really relevant to modern machine learning. So it's very important course today. So first, let's recall what was the setting of a binary classification we talked about last time. So as usual in supervised learning, you have a data set S, which consists of some observation xi, yi, for I from 1 to n. Okay, you have n observations. And your input x will belong to some set x, and your input y will belong to a discrete set. And in the case of binary classification, today we will say this set is 0, 1, okay? You could have said it is -1, 1, it would not change a lot. But today we say yi belong to 0, 1. And as usual, what is the goal? The goal is that we'll give you a new observation x, and you would like to predict what is its associated label. You know what, to which class does your observation X belong? And so how you will do that, you will use your training data, XI, YI. You will use some learning algorithm in order to learn a classifier. And with this classifier, you will do your prediction. So that's the general setting of binary classification. Just a point about notation, because I had some questions last time. So often, when we will use lowercase later, like this, xi, yi, it means that we are talking about observation, okay? We are talking about vectors that are fixed. And when I will use capital later, I will often talk about random variable, okay? So I will try to be precise about it during the course, but maybe sometimes I will do some mistake, which is not too important. But just to have in mind, I will always use some bold letters when I will talk about the matrix design, okay? When I will talk about the matrix X with all the features X1 to XN, this will be in bold. So what is the motivation for logistic regression? So last time what we saw in the class about classification, we saw that in fact, in order to do a classification, it was possible not to directly predict the output, 0 or 1, but it was possible instead to model the probability, okay? So we were modeling the probability that the observation X belonged to the class 1 and the probability that the observation X belonged to the class 0. So, okay, so instead of doing really like a prediction, so instead of predicting if the customer will default to in our credit score test, what we would say is that we will predict the probability that the customer will default. Okay. And then with this probability, it was possible to do a prediction. If the probability was larger than 0.5, then you will predict that you will belong to the class 1. And if the probability of belonging to the class 1 is smaller than 0.5, you will predict that you belong to the class 0. Okay. So first, you are learning the probability, and then you do your prediction. And so the question is, how can you learn the probability? How will you model the probability of belonging to one class? And I don't know if you remember, but so last time we did that by assuming a linear model. Okay, so we were assuming that the probability that the label of the observation X was 1 was some linear function of W and X. So this is what we were doing, where we were using linear regression to solve the classification problem. And so what was the two problems with this modeling? The first one was that the predicted value was not in 0, 1. Since this is a linear function, this is not restricted to 0, 1. So if you, I mean, this number can be very large or very negative. So that was the first problem. And the second problem, which was really more important, was a problem with the very extreme values of the prediction. So do you remember this? The problem was that when we were adding some very, very large value, then we were suffering a very large square loss. Whereas what we said was, in fact, these values were not outliers, but were very easy points, which was easy to predict. You just want to be very confident in your prediction. Okay? So that was a problem with least square error, where we are still paying a very large price, even when we should have been very convinced of our prediction. Okay? And so you see that, in fact, what you would like to do is, if you're observing some very, very, very large value, you just want to be very sure that this one will belong to the class one. So in fact, what you would like to have is that when you have some very, very large value, you want the probability to be very close to one. And if you have some very, very negative value, you want the probability to be very close to 0, not to minus infinity or to plus infinity. And so how we will do that, how we will solve this problem, what we will try to do is that we will map minus infinity plus infinity to 0, 1. Okay? So you can see that exactly what you want to do. What you want to do is that if you have some very large value for the prediction, you want your probability to be very close to one. And if you have some very negative value for your prediction, you want your probability to be very close to 0. So you see that, in fact, what we want to do is still to use a linear model, but then map this linear prediction from minus infinity to plus infinity, from this set to the set 0, 1. And so then the question is, how can you do this? And so you can use a lot of different functions. I mean, it exists a lot of functions which will map minus infinity to plus, minus infinity plus infinity to 0, 1. And the logistic regression, we'll use one particular such function, which is called the logistic function. Okay? Is it clear for the motivation? Yes? Very nice. So for the logistic regression, we'll use the function which is called logistic function. So this is a function which dates back from 1830. And so what is the definition of this function? For eta, a real number, logistic function of eta, which we will denote by sigma eta, will just be equal to exponential of eta divided by 1 plus exponential of eta. Okay? Very simple definition. And so here you see a plot of this function, which is very characteristic S shape of the curve. And you see that this function is exactly doing what you want. In 0, so that means when you are not too sure about what you want to say, the value of the logistic function will exactly be 1/2. Then you see that when eta goes to infinity, the logistic function will go to 1. And when eta goes to minus infinity, the logistic function will go to 0. So we exactly recover what we want. If eta is very large, the probability will be close to 1. If eta is very, very negative, the probability will be close to 0. But what is important is that you see it will be close to 1, but it will never be above 1. And it will be close to 0, but it will never be below 0. So the image of all the real by the logistic function is really exactly 0, 1. So this function is mapping all the real to the interval 0, 1 of the probabilities. Okay? And so you see that using the logistic function, regardless of the value of eta, we will always obtain some sensible prediction. We will always obtain something which will be possible to interpret as a probability. Is all good with the logistic function? And so this function has also some nice properties, which are only, you know, it's just some small computation, but we will do them now because we will use them a lot today. So the first one is I can compute 1 minus the logistic function of eta. Okay. So 1, I just write it is 1 plus epsilon exponential of epsilon divided by 1 plus exponential of epsilon minus sigma eta minus exponential eta over 1 plus exponential eta. And so you directly see that what is happening, the exponential of eta are canceling, and you directly obtain 1 over 1 plus exponential of eta. Okay, so this is a small computation. 1 minus sigma is equal to inverse of 1 plus exponential eta. Then the second computation will be about the derivative of the logistic function. So in order to take the derivative, what you are doing derivative of exponential of eta. It is exponential of eta, so you get exponential of eta over 1 plus exponential eta minus exponential eta times the derivative of 1 over 1 plus exponential eta. And this will give you this second term. So when you put them under the same form, you will get exponential of eta divided by 1 plus exponential of eta squared. And here you exactly recognize this is equal to sigma times 1 minus sigma. Okay. So you see that the derivative of the logistic function is equal to the logistic function times 1 minus sigma. What can you directly prove using this equality? What can you prove that you see on the plot? It? What is always positive? So exactly. Sigma is between 0 and 1. So 1 minus sigma will also be between 0 and 1. So the product will be positive because the product of two positive numbers is a positive number. And so the derivative will be positive. And so the function will be increasing. Okay. So this we will use it a lot today. So then, how are we using this logistic function? So we will use a logistic function in order to model the probability. So this is exactly why it is like the logistic regression, because the logistic regression will model the probability that y belongs to a particular class using the logistic function sigma. So you see, I will model the probability that y is equal to 1 when x is equal to x as the logistic function of my linear prediction. And this, here you see that I'm using some capital letter because this y is some random variable. That's really like the probability that my random, the label of my random variable is equal to 1 when I observe x. I will denote it by p of 1 knowing x. Okay, this is just like a number, this is a function. This is exactly the value when y is equal to 1 and x is equal to x. Okay, this is just like a notation. So the logistic regression will use the logistic function in order to model the probability to belong to some class. So the probability of being in the class 1 will be equal to sigma of my linear prediction, x transpose w plus my shift. And the probability to be in the class 0 will exactly be equal to 1 minus the probability of being in the class 1. Okay, so it will be equal to 1 minus the logistic function evaluated in my linear prediction. And it's important to have in mind that the two classes have exactly the same importance, and you could have called like the class 1, 0, and the class 0, 1. Okay, it will not change anything. You can flip anything. You can flip as you want. Okay, so this is exactly what is a logistic regression. And so why is it called logistic regression? It is called logistic because you are using the logistic function to model your probabilities. And then it is called a regression, because instead of directly predicting the output y, what you will do is that you will first predict the probability that x is in some class. That's the first step, that's the regression step. And in the second step, you will do your prediction. And so how you will do the prediction? You will quantize the probability. If p of one knowing x, so if the probability that x is in the class one is larger than 1/2, then you are predicting the class one. Okay. If you are predicting that it is more likely that you belong to the class one, you say that the class will be one. And on the contrary, if you are predicting that it is more likely that you belong to the class zero, so this is a typo, okay. If p of zero is larger than 1/2, you will predict the class zero. Okay, so there is a typo here, I'm being cautious. Okay, so first you are learning the probability, and then you use this probability in order to do your prediction. And you can see this is exactly doing what you want, because if you have some very large value of your linear prediction, okay, then this will correspond to the probability of being in the class one to be either very close to zero or very close to one. So if you have some very large value here, you will be able to predict with some very high confidence. But if you have some very small value, then that means that the probability will be very close to 0.5, and you will predict, but with a very low confidence. And so you see that it is exactly solving the problem we had last time. Because for the very large value of x, this number will be very large, but now we will not anymore suffer a very large square error between this number and one. Since we are mapping it back to the probability space, we will just have this, that the probability will be very close to one. Okay? So is it clear for all this? Yes?
So basically, when x transpose times w is greater than zero, we predict the label one. And otherwise, we predict the label zero, right?
Yeah, exactly. So the question is, when this number is positive, you will predict the class one. And if this number is negative, you will predict the class zero. Because if you are looking at the value, it is exactly equal to 1/2 in zero. And when the value is positive, it will be larger than 1/2. And when the value is negative, it will be below 1/2. So that's a very good point, and we will talk about it later. That you could say that for the prediction, if I give you a W and I give you a W zero, all this does not change a lot. Because when you want to do some prediction, you do not really care if this number, if the probability is very close to one, or it just above 1/2. Okay. If you predict, you just need to know if it will be above or below 1/2. But you can still use this prediction to do some uncertainty, estimation, you know, that you could take it into account in your prediction. If this value is very large and you are really sure that it will belong to the class one, and if it's just above 0.5, then you are not so sure. So it's still important. So let's see how using the logistic function is solving all the problem we saw last time with the linear regression. So we are still analyzing, you know, this credit score problem. So here we have the logistic regression example. Here we have the linear regression example. And I don't know if you remember, that was the example where the data set was well balanced. And for this example, linear regression was working quite well. So you see that the threshold you are obtaining with both methods is very close, okay? I don't know the exact value. I don't know if it's exactly the same, but the two thresholds are very close. So the two decision boundaries are exactly the same. So here what we are gaining is that we really have some probabilities with the logistic function, whereas previously we had this value which were above one or below zero, and so it was not possible to use them as probabilities. Okay. So now with the logistic function, if I am very much on one side, I can be very sure that my prediction will be true and will be one, and that the same in the other side. Okay. Then this is maybe a more interesting case. Now we had this example where where the data set was not balanced, which means that I had a lot more points in one of the class. And what we saw last time with linear regression, so when you were fitting directly a linear fit to do your prediction, we saw that the decision boundary was shifted by a large amount. Okay. Previously, if it was balanced, we were predicting that if you have below 1,000, let's say 300, you will not make default. But if you are above 1,300, you will default. But now with my data set, where I have more points here, you see that my new threshold is around 3,000. So the linear regression method is not working at all. Okay. And you see that when you are using the logistic function, when you are using logistic regression, you still have a shift in your decision boundary, but it's a little bit better. Okay. You are only going from 1,300 to 90,000, let's say. 19,000. So you see that by using this mapping from minus infinity to plus infinity, it's also prevent us to be too sensible to unbalanced data. We are still sensible, we still have a shift, but this shift is a lot better than the one we had with the linear regression. You have some questions on this? No. I know it's really even more interesting for the case of extreme values. So you remember for the linear regression case, when we were adding some very, very, very large value, okay, we really had the curve, the inclination of the curve, which was changing, and a very large shift in the decision boundary. And so that's why this method was not working at all, because point with a very large value of x, you were still suffering from a very large square loss, whereas you should have a method which is not suffering any loss, because for a large value, you should be sure of your prediction. And you see that now with the logistic regression, we almost find exactly the same prediction with and without these extreme values. Okay, so you see that the logistic regression has exactly solved the extreme value problem. Okay. And this is because the extreme value are really in the right direction. If your prediction, if your x value is very large, then the value you will predict with your, with your linear fit will be also very large. And so then your probability will be very close to one. So you see with this example that the logistic function is really helping you to do exactly what you want. Okay. So with the logistic function, if you are very much in one side, then your probability is very close to one. Do you have some question on these comparisons? So let's look a little bit more about, how does it look, this function? What is the shape of all this function? So what we will do is that we are taking this two-dimensional example. Okay, I have something in 2D, so I will have two features, x1 and x2. And so two weights, w1 and w2. And what I will look at the value of my logistic function in W transpose X. And I want to see, you know, what is the role of the vector W. So I will just consider a lot of different vector W and I fix the scale of W, okay? First, I just want to see what is the role of the direction of W. It's working. Okay, so you see that if you are changing the direction of W, so what you can see is that really like the vector W is orthogonal to the surface of transition. Okay, so you will go from 0 to 1, and you will have a surface where the transition surface, and the vector W is telling you, I mean, it's giving you the direction of this transition. Okay, so the transition between the two levels really happen at the hyperplane, which is the orthogonal of W. Okay, so it happened at the hyperplane of all the vector, which will be orthogonal to W. So if we see now on this example, I mean, if I stop it, this will correspond to W is equal to one zero. And so you see that the transition will happen exactly at the space, which is exactly x1 is equal to 0. So you see that exactly that space. Is it clear for this? You have your, yeah? Yeah, exactly. Or the labels is when this is equal to -1 and this is equal to 1, or when this is below 0.5. No, sorry, when this is equal to 0 and 1, or when is this below to 0.5 or above 0.5. Okay. So that's very important. The vector W, if you just look at its direction, it will give you where the transition is happening. And so the transition is exactly happening at the hyperplane W orthogonal. Okay, that's the hyperplane of all the vectors which are perpendicular to W. And so we see that in this particular example where, okay, so this is minus W. So you see W will be here, and so will be exactly equal to the vector 1, 0. You see that the transition, okay, so the transition is for which point, you know, you will go from predicting the class 0 to predicting the class 1. So where this where this transition is happening, it is exactly at this hyperplane. So where we are in 2D, so the hyperplane is a line. So it's exactly this line. So when you look at your space of the X, if your X is on one side of this line, then you will predict the class 0. And if you are on the other side of this line, you will predict the class 1. Okay. So if you want, it was like, I mean, like last time when we were talking about linear prediction and separation hyperplane. Okay, this really the hyperplane which will help you to do, I mean, which will help you to do the prediction between the class 0 and the class 1. And you see that this hyperplane is given by W. And so this is what we are looking in this animation. When you change the orientation of W, you change the position of the transition. Yes? So the arrow is negative W. That's a very good point. Okay. The arrow is negative W. Otherwise, it would be below the red and you won't see it. Just like for visualization purpose. But you really see that by changing the orientation of W, you are changing the position of your transition. Okay? So that's for the direction of W. Then the next question is, when you have fixed the direction, what will be the impact of the scale of W? Because you can take W of very small scale, like you can take this norm of W to be very small, and you can take the norm of W to be very large. Okay, so what we want to see is what will be the impact of the length of the vector W. So what do you think? So it's written, but in some sense. What do we want to say is that if the norm of W is very small, then the transition will be very slow. And that's exactly what you see here. Here, the norm of W is almost zero. And so you see that the transition is very, very slow. When I just look at my graph between minus 10 and 10, I just see something very flat. Okay, I will have to go to minus infinity to see the transition happening. And so what is happening now when I'm playing with the scale of W? You see, I go from something which is very, very flat to something from a very stiff transition. Okay, so you see, when the scale of W change, you really make the transition faster or slower. So if you use a W with a very small scale, then the probability you will predict will often be not too strong. You know, it will be very difficult to predict a probability close to one or close to zero. Because for this, you will have to have some value of X transpose W to be very, very, very large. But since W is very small, that means that you really need to have X align with W and the norm of X to be very, very large. So the scale of W when it is small makes that you will do some probability very close to 0.5, okay? But then when the scale of W is very large, then you see that your logistic function will go to the Heaviside function, to the step function, is what you see at the end. It will really be, you will always predict the probability to be zero or the probability to be one. Okay? So this is what happens when you take a very large W. You take a very large W, you are very certain. Okay? Either you belong to the class one or you belong to the class zero. But your probability will always be very, very close to one or zero. Never in between. And so this is what I wanted to say previously. That shows that in order to make predictions, this will not play an important role. Because when you want to do prediction, you just care about is your probability above or below 1/2. But if you want to use this probability to compute or other things, or if you want to be able to quantify the uncertainty of your prediction, you see that the scale of the W will be very important. If you have a small W, that means that you will do your prediction, but you will never be too certain about your prediction. Okay, you will say maybe it belongs to the class one, but let's say with probability 0.66, you know? If the scale of W is very, very large, then that means that you are always very certain of your prediction, okay? It will belong to the class one with a probability one. So this is the importance of the scale of W. We saw the importance of the direction of W. But in all the examples we saw, we are never talking about W zero. And we talked about it last time during the last course. You know, there is no reason that your hyperplane, that your separation hyperplane is stopping by zero, okay? And so it's very important to also think about the shift term, about the W zero. And so what is the impact of W zero? So W zero will really help you to shift the decision region along the vector W. Okay, so the W, the direction, will give you the position of the hyperplane transition. And then with W zero, you will be able to move along this direction. So this is exactly what you see with the animation. I'm playing with W zero between -6 and 6. And you see that the transition is moving between -6 and 6. Exactly what you see. will go from minus 6 plus 6. That's exactly the same with the second example. Okay. So the direction of W is giving you the position of the separating hyperplane. The scale of W is giving you the shape of the prediction. And then the shift is exactly telling you, you know, where exactly the transition is happening along the vector W. Is it clear for the importance of these three features of W and W0? Yes? Okay, and what we said last time is that in practice, it's really important to consider this shift W, okay? Because there is no reason that your data set will be centered around zero, so you will always have to learn this W0 in your model, okay? So what you really want when you are doing, when you are modeling your probability, you really want to include this shift W0. But for simplicity, when we will do the analyze, what we will often do is that instead of having this real W0, which is a little bit annoying, we will just add a constant to the features. So you will consider your feature and you will add just one. And like this, you will not learn W and W0 in your space of dimension D, but sorry, you will consider X. So this is RD. You will consider X in RD plus one. And so what you will learn is directly W, W0, which will also belong to RD plus one. Okay, so these are exactly equivalent, these two options. They're exactly the same. It's just for notation. For notation, we will prefer to remove this term and to just consider W transpose X. But in the application, you should not forget to add the constant term in your features. That's very important. Because otherwise, if you are only learning W transpose X without the constant, you will only learn an hyperplane with stop by zero. And if your observation X are just far away and not centered around zero, it does not make any sense. So in application, do not forget to add the one. Okay, so what have we done in the first part of the course? We have defined what is a logistic regression. And we have seen how it was possible to make a prediction if I was giving you a vector W and a shift W0. Okay. So now you know how to make a prediction if I give you your classifier. And so now what we will do in the last 5 minutes of the first part and in the second part of the course, we will see how is it possible to do the training. How, when I will give you some data, you will be able to learn the vector W. Okay. So how do you think we can do? What will be the technique to learn your predictor W? So what have you done when it was about least squares? Exactly. So what you will do is that you will use what is called the maximum likelihood estimation, ML. So let's talk a little bit about it. So the question is, how is it possible to find the parameter W? You know what to do with W. If I give you a W, you will be able to do your prediction, but now you want to find W. And so I don't know if you remember what you have seen with Martin about least square. But when you were doing regression in least square, you define what was a least square estimator. And so when you talk about least square, you arrive to the least square estimator using two different justifications. Do you remember what was the first one? It was a geometric intuition. Do you remember the geometric intuition behind least squares? You want to find the line which will minimize the fit between your y and your prediction. Okay, so you are really minimizing the mean square error. That was the first way to derive the least square estimator, minimizing your quadratic error. But then you also saw a second interpretation, which was a probabilistic interpretation. So what was the probabilistic interpretation of the least square? Who remember? Someone? So it was that also in order to do the least square, what you can assume is that your observation y is equal to the true fit w transpose x plus some error. And when you were assuming that this error were Gaussian, okay, where zero mean random variable following a normal law, so when this error was Gaussian, then if you were doing the maximum likelihood on this model will directly give you the least square estimator. Okay, so you saw that for least square, you could define the estimate, you could find the W using some geometric intuition or some using some probabilistic intuition. And so now we will do exactly the same. We will use a probabilistic intuition in order to learn our parameter W. And so this is what is called the maximum likelihood estimation. Okay. So that's really like a way to estimate the parameter of a statistical model. You are assuming a statistical model on your data. It will be that you're assuming that the probability that X belongs to the class Y1 will be equal to sigma of X transpose W. This is a statistical model. And using the MLE, you will be able to find the parameter W, which will be the most likely for your observation. So what is the MLE? I give you some ID samples, Z1 to Zn, which are following some probability. Okay, you have a statistical model. So you know that the probability of observing Z1, Zn will be equal to this number, which is a function of W. And so the maximum likelihood estimation will really be the estimation method which will find the parameter W star under which the observation you are seeing are the most likely. Okay? So just to be clear, you have a statistical model. And what you don't know about the statistical model is the value of W. Okay? You just know that your observation are following some law, but you do not know what is the parameter of this law. For example, you can know that you're observing some Gaussian vector, but you do not know the mean of this Gaussian vector and you don't know the variance. So what you will look at some observation and you will say that the parameter of the observation you are looking at are exactly the one such that the probability of seeing exactly this value will be the higher. Okay? So really like the MLE, it will find the parameter W under which the data are the most likely. Okay. So we have this function, L of W, this is the likelihood function. And what is the likelihood function? It is exactly, it is a function of W, and that exactly the probability of observing Z1 to Zn, when you are assuming that Z1 and Zn are following your statistical model with parameter W. Okay. And so the maximum likelihood estimator will really be W star, which will maximize this probability. So before the break, we were talking about MLE. And what we said is that, as the name was suggesting, MLE was exactly the method for which you will find the parameter under which the data are the most likely, okay? So when you are looking at this probability, you see that this probability can be seen as a function only of your parameter W. So this is called the likelihood function. And so the maximum likelihood estimation and the maximum likelihood estimator will exactly be the maximizer of your likelihood. You see, that's really simple. And since your observations z1 to zn are independent and identically distributed, this probability of z1 to zn will be exactly equal to the product of the probability of z1 knowing w. Okay? So that's it for the maximum likelihood estimation. But in practice, we don't really like products, and we don't really like to maximize functions. And we prefer to have some sum, and we prefer to minimize. And so what we are doing and what we are considering is the negative log likelihood. So it's just you are taking the negative of the logarithm of the likelihood, and you will minimize this criteria. So this is what is called the negative log likelihood. And you see, since you are taking the logarithm of the product, you will get a sum. And that's the general formula you will use. And this is what you will use in order to find W star. You will often minimize this function. Okay. And so the question is, you know, why does it make sense to do this MLE? What are the theoretical justifications? So typically, the theoretical justification is that if your data z1 to zn were really generated by your statistical model, and if you were having a number of data going to infinity, then by doing the MLE, you will recover the true parameter of your model. Okay? So if you have a random Gaussian vector of mean mu, and you're observing a lot of samples x1 to xn such that xi is a Gaussian of mean mu, and you do the MLE, if n is going to infinity, you will recover your true mean mu. Okay? So this is what we say, that it is a consistent estimator. If your sample complexity is going to infinity, then you will recover your true parameter. And I'm just adding you that this is not always true. You have to assume some small technical conditions. Okay, but in practice, you can think of as being true. If your number of data is going to infinity, by doing the MLE, you will recover your true parameter. But only if your data was really generated according to your model. So in practice, this would not be true. Okay, in your real life, there is almost no hope that your data will follow the model you want to put on. Okay, in real life, there is no hope that, you know, the grade of a course will be Gaussians. We are just modeling them by some Gaussians. But still, the MLE is important because it's a good safeguard. Okay, if your data are not too far from the distribution you try to fit, then it can still work. Okay. So this is for the formal definition of the MLE and of the negative log likelihood. So it's a general method to find the parameter of a statistical model. And what we will do now is that we will apply this general method to the logistic regression problem in order to find the parameter W. So what is the first step? The first step is to compute the likelihood function of your model. And to do so, what we will do is that we will do a first assumption, which is an assumption, but it is really natural. So you see now, capital S is bold. So that means that this X is a matrix with all my observation x1 to xn. And so what I am assuming is that my observation x1 to xn are not depending on the parameter W I'm trying to find, okay? I'm assuming that my input is independent of my parameter W. So using this assumption, I can compute my likelihood function. So the likelihood function is the probability of observing y and x. Here, y is also in bold because this is a vector with all my y1 to yn. And I just say that this is exactly equal to the probability of observing x knowing w times the probability of observing y knowing x and w. Okay, this is basic probability. And now what I will do is that I will use the fact that x and w are independent. I'm using the fact that my observation x are not depending on w. And so how I will use this fact, I will use the fact that the probability of observing x knowing w will exactly be equal to the probability of observing x. Okay, x is independent of w. So you see that this number will be some number, and this will be something which will not depend on w. And since what I want to do at the end will be to maximize this function or to minimize the negative logarithm of this function, I will be able to throw this term away. Okay, this term will not change my problem because this term is not depending on w. So the only term I will care about is that term. It will be the probability of observing y, knowing x and w. So this is what I want to compute. So using the ID, the fact that the observation are ID, this is exactly equal to the product for one for y between one and n. So the product over all my observation of the probability of observing yi, knowing xi and w. Okay, this is just the fact that probability of independent event is equal to the product of the probability. And so now what we want to do is that we want to write this under a simplified form. So the first thing I'm doing, I will split this product in two parts. In one part, I will put all the yi whose value are one. And the other part, I will put all the yi whose value are zero. So the product over all the yi will be equal to the product over the yi, over the i such as the yi are equal to one. Okay. Times the product such that the yi is equal to zero. This is simple, yes? And now what I want is that I want to rewrite this. So this, I know that this should be equal to sigma xi transpose w, but I want to rewrite it as a unique form which will work for the both case. So what you can observe is that this will exactly give you what you want. So let's look at this quantity. When yi is equal to one, this quantity is equal to sigma xi transpose w power yi, and yi is equal to one. So this is exactly equal to this quantity. And the second term, I have one minus yi. So yi is equal to one, so one minus yi is equal to zero. So one minus sigma power zero will be equal to one. So this term, when yi is equal to one, is exactly equal to sigma xi transpose w. So when yi is equal to one, this term is equal to this term. Then when yi is equal to zero, this term power zero will be equal to one. And this term will be equal to one minus sigma xi transpose w. And so this term, when yi is equal to zero, will be exactly equal to the probability of yi equals zero knowing xi and w. So if you think a little bit more, you should see that this product is exactly equal to this product. Okay. Yes. And then why the binomial distribution will be written under this form? What? Bernoulli. Yes, I mean, that the definition of logistic will be equivalent to Bernoulli. But the question is why the Bernoulli distribution can be written under this form, which is non-trivial. Bernoulli distribution, what it is? It's a random variable which can value 0 or 1, and it's equal to 1 with some probability eta, and 0 with probability minus 1 minus eta. It's not directly clear that you can rewrite the Bernoulli distribution under this form. This is what we just kind of proved. Okay. So is it clear how we go from this quantity to this product? We just consider the product over all the observation using the independence. We split between the yi, which are equal to 1, and the yi, which are equal to 0. And then we see that we can write them under the same form. And so we can merge them again. Okay. So we have this equality for this term. And so this is giving you that the likelihood will be proportional to this function of W. It is proportional because I have this term. But what I'm telling you is that I do not care about this term. What I will do is that I will minimize the function so I can throw this term away. And so what is the second step? I told you that I don't like this function because I don't like to maximize function. I don't know how to maximize function. What I know is how to minimize function, because I like convexity. I prefer convexity over concavity. And also, I don't like product. I don't like to do the product of a lot of numbers. Okay, that's something I'm not very confident with. So the second step will be to consider the negative log likelihood. So I will exactly take this term I have computed before, and I will take minus the log. So what I like obtaining. I take minus the log of this product. Product log of the product is equal to the sum of the log. So I get exactly this. Now you see that here I have also product of a lot of terms. So I will have the log of sigma power yi plus the log of 1 minus sigma power 1 minus yi. And then I will use the fact that log of f power alpha is equal to alpha log of f. So you see that the log of this quantity is exactly equal to yi log of this quantity. And I can do exactly the same for the second part of the product. So I directly get minus the sum over all my observation of yi times log of sigma xi transpose w plus 1 minus yi, the log of 1 minus sigma xi transpose w. But still, I want to simplify this again. So what I will do? So first, I will factorize by yi. So I will get yi times this log minus this log. And you know that the difference between two log will be equal to log. So log A minus log B is equal to log A over B. So I will get this. The log of 1 minus sigma over sigma. And now I still have this term. And now I have my minus also, okay? So I had a minus, so it directly give me the other side. And so I know I have the minus, 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 so plus, minus plus 1, so minus log 1 minus sigma. So I get this. And now I want to simplify this again. And in order to simplify this again, we will use what we have seen in the first slide about the logistic function. So I will use the fact that 1 minus the logistic function is equal to 1 over 1 plus exponential of eta. So that's the first thing I will use. So this is telling me that this one minus sigma will be equal exactly to one plus exponential of eta. So you see that this should give you this. Yeah, okay, good. It is giving you exactly this because you will have the log of one over one plus exponential eta. So this is equal to minus the log of one plus exponential eta, and minus minus give you plus. Okay. So you go from this term to this term. Simple computation. And now what we want, we also want to simplify this. And in order to simplify this, we need to compute one minus sigma over sigma. And what you can see is that one minus sigma over sigma is exactly equal to exponential minus eta. So why we say that one minus sigma eta is equal to one over one plus exponential? I know that sigma eta is exactly equal to exponential over one plus exponential. So when I will divide this, I will multiply this by one plus exponential over exponential. So it will give me one over exponential of eta. So it will give me exponential of minus eta. So I can plug this here. And what I will get the log of the exponential of minus xi w. So the log of the exponential, it gives me identity. And so what I am obtaining is exactly yi times xi transpose w. Okay, so you see that you directly go from this to minus yi xi transpose w. So at the end, you have simplified your negative log likelihood as this function. And this is the cost function we would like to minimize in order to find our optimal parameter. And so you see that the function will just be the sum over your observation of a linear term, minus yi xi transpose w plus a logarithmic term, log of one plus exponential xi transpose w. So this is the cost function we will be interested in today. And what I'm telling you is that minimizing this cost function is exactly the same as maximizing my likelihood. Because I have just removed this term, but this term is independent of W. So W star will exactly be the maximum likelihood estimator. That's the first point. And the second point, which is important to make, is that if you would have considered not 0, 1 for your labels, but minus 1, 1, then you would have obtained a different loss. Okay, you would have a different function. And in practice, sometimes, I mean, if you look at different implementation of logistic regression, and we will also talk about it in the SVM course, you will see that you can have different functions. So you have to be careful about, are you assuming that your labels are in minus 1, 1, or that your labels are in 0, 1? This will give you different functions to minimize. So is it clear for the minimum of the negative log likelihood? So just what is important to have in mind is that by doing the MLE, you get some function, which is in a nice form. This is a sum. And what we will like to do now is to minimize this function. It's not important to remember how we are deriving this function. But just for you, that's the kind of simple computation you have to be able to do again, okay? All this small trick is not too complicated, but this is something you have to be able to do for the exam, for example. So now we want to minimize this function. So what is the first question we will ask about this function. We want to minimize the function. So that's the second question we will ask, if the function is convex or not. What is the first function? Remember about least squares. For least squares, you had a loss function, a cost function. It was a sum of the quadratic loss. And you wanted to minimize it. And so what you did, exactly, you look at for the, I mean, you look for the stationary point. You take the gradient and you look at the solution, the gradient equal to zero. So let's compute the gradient of this cost function. So this is just a function I had derived in the last, in the previous slide. And I want to take the gradient of this function. Okay, so this is simple computation. I have my gradient of a sum. This is equal to the sum of the gradient. And now I want to take the gradient of log of one plus exponential. So this is exactly equal. Derivative of the log is one over the function. So I get my one plus exponential. And then I have to take the derivative of this term. It gives me this term. Okay. So the gradient of the log is equal to this term. And then I want to take the gradient of my linear function xi transpose w. This is equal to xi. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is a typo. Thank you a lot. Many thanks. Okay. So the xi come from when you are taking the derivative of this, it would be xi times exponential of xi transpose w. Good catch. And so here, what we are recovering is exactly the logistic function. Okay. So you see that the gradient is exactly equal to the sum of the logistic function in xi transpose w minus yi times xi. Okay. And so we can write it under a more compact form when we are using the design matrix x and the design vector y. You can convince yourself that this sum is exactly equal to this matrix computation. It will be equal to your design matrix transpose times sigma of xw. And so xw is a matrix times a vector. So this would be a vector. And so sigma applied to a vector will just be sigma applied to each component of the vector. So this is a vector. Matrix times a vector will give you a vector, and you see that this will exactly give you the sum of, I mean, it will give you this sum. So what can we say about this gradient? First, you can observe that it's exactly the same gradient as for the least square, but we have in addition this function sigma. If I remove the sigma, you are observing the same gradient as for the least square. But the fact that I have sigma will change a lot. It means that I don't have any closed form solution. If my gradient is equal to zero, it's not possible to give me a closed form solution for W. So we will not have a closed form solution, but still we will be able to minimize the function because the function will be convex. And so this is the second thing we will show. We will try to show that this function is convex. So how can we do? How can we show that this function is a convex function of W? So we can show that it Hessian, so the matrix of the second derivative is positive definite, then one way. In the second way, how can we do it? Do you have an idea? Without looking at the next slide. So often a nice way to show that such function is convex is to start from some building blocks. Okay, you have some nice operation which will preserve the convexity, and we will play with them. So the claim is that my function L of W, my cos function is convex of W. And how I will prove it in a simple case, I will show that my cos function L is obtained through some simple convexity preserving operations. Okay? So it's like a Lego game. I give you some small brick, and with this small brick, you will do something larger. So what are the simple operations? The first one is that if you have two convex functions, any positive combination of this convex function will still be positive convex. So f is convex, g is convex, alpha and beta are positive, alpha f plus beta g will be convex. First result we will use. Then we will use some composition results. If you have a convex function and you take the composition of this convex function with a linear function, it will be convex. So f convex means that f of W transpose X will be convex in W. That's the second brick. The third brick will be that a linear function, that's one of the simplest functions, it will be both convex and concave. Okay? That's the only function which will be both convex and concave. And the last brick will be that this function, logarithm of 1 plus exponential of eta, is a convex function. So this is a real function, and we want to show that it is convex. So often, the easiest to show that is to do what? Exactly, it will be the solution will be to compute the second derivative. So let's look at the proof. I want to show that my function h of eta is convex. I will just compute the derivative and then take the second derivative. So my derivative, I mean, we already did it. It's 1 plus exponential eta, because derivative of the log is 1 over x, times the derivative of 1 plus exponential eta, which is exponential eta. So you see that h prime is exactly equal to sigma eta. And now, the second derivative of h would be the derivative of sigma. And this is what we have already computed at the beginning of the course. We can compute it again. And you see it will be something positive. The second formula was this is equal to sigma times 1 minus sigma. So this is the second proof that it is positive. So you see that the second derivative of h is positive. So the function log 1 plus exponential eta is convex. So we have our 4 building blocks, and we will play with them. So first, using that a composition of a convex and a linear function is convex, this is telling me that it would tell me that all this is convex, okay? Because I will take the combination of this function and a linear function. So in fact, I'm not using 0.2. I'm just using 4 and 2. And this is directly giving me that the log of 1 plus exponential xi transpose w is convex, okay? It is convex as a composition of a convex function and a linear function. So this is convex. Now I will use the fact. Okay, I'm still missing the xi everywhere. No, it's good. So this is convex. Now I will use the fact that a linear function is convex. So this function is convex. And so now that it's telling me that the sum of these two convex functions is also convex. And I'm doing the sum of a lot of them. And so L is convex. Is it clear? Any typo on the slide? I don't know. All good? OK, so like this, we see that the cos function is convex. And how we did that, we just play around with some simple convexity preserving rule. The second way to show that the function would be convex, as one of you said before, was is to compute the matrix of the second derivatives. So, okay, this is called the Hessian matrix, nabla 2 of L, and that's really like the matrix whose entries are the second derivative, okay? Every entries of nabla 2 of L is equal to the derivative with respect to Wi and to Wj. This is giving you a matrix. You will compute this matrix. And if this matrix is positive semi-definite, that means that your function is convex. So in order to compute the Hessian, we will take the nabla of the transpose of the gradient. So this was the formula for the gradient. I take transpose and I put it inside the sum. And you see that xi transpose is giving me exactly this. And now I will get the gradient of this quantity. And in order to get the gradient of this quantity, what you will have is that it will be exactly equal to the derivative of this function times xi. Okay. And the derivative of the function sigma, we already seen previously, it was equal to sigma times 1 minus sigma. So when I'm taking the gradient of this function, this is exactly equal to sigma xi transpose w times 1 minus sigma xi transpose w times xi. This is a simple computation. And you see that this can be rewrite, can be a simple exercise, as this matrix. I have my design matrix transpose times some positive matrix S, I mean some matrix X times X. And what is the definition of X, of S? It will be exactly the diagonal matrix. Okay, it will be a diagonal matrix, and each component of the diagonal will be exactly sigma XI transpose W times 1 minus sigma XI transpose W. And you see that each of these terms is positive, because sigma times 1 minus sigma is positive. So this is a diagonal matrix whose diagonal entries are positive. And so this is a positive matrix. And so this matrix will be PSD. Okay? That's an easy exercise to do to show that a matrix like this is PSD. How can you do this? What is the definition of a PSD matrix? Exactly. So you will be able to show that V times nabla 2 L theta times V will be positive for every V. Okay. That's a way. And this is direct with this formula. Anyway, so then how can we minimize a convex function? We will have to be a little bit fast because we only have 10 minutes left. So the first way you have seen in the course to minimize a convex function will be to use a gradient descent algorithm. Okay, so you are computing the gradient of your function, and at each step you are going in the negative gradient direction. You have already seen that with Martin. The problem with gradient descent is that often it can be slow. And in particular, it will be slow if the number of data you have is very large. Do you see why? Why, if n is very large, your gradient computation will be very small, very slow? Yes? Can you say it again? No. Why do you want to invert a gradient? My gradient is equal, I will have later. You are not inverting it. But when you are computing your gradient, you are computing a sum over all your data. So if n is very large, each time you want to compute a gradient, you will have to do a sum over n terms. Okay, so if n is equal to 10 billion, this will take you too much time. So that's why often in machine learning, we are not using gradient descent, but we prefer to use an algorithm called stochastic gradient descent, where instead of computing the full gradient, you will only sample one indices between 1 and n, okay, uniformly. And you will only look at the gradient for this observation. And so you look at if you take the expectation of this quantity over it, where it is uniform over 1 and n, over 1 n, then you will exactly recover the sum of all the, of all the gradient in each observation. And so you will recover your true gradient. Okay? So SGD, instead of following the true gradient, you will follow an estimate of your gradient. But you see that now what is the complexity of computing this? It will be O of one. It's not depending on your number of observations. You can have n as large as you want. Each step of SGD will only cost you O of one. So the algorithm will be faster to implement. Each step when you are computing a gradient will be very fast. But the convergence rate will be slower. You will need to do more steps in order to converge to the solution. That's the main difference between gradient descent, GD, and stochastic gradient descent, SGD. Gradient descent takes you a lot of time to compute your gradient, but then your convergence is not too slow. SGD, you are computing a gradient very efficiently, but you will have to do more steps. And when you look at the trade-off in machine learning, almost always SGD at the end will converge faster when you will look at the number of computation you have done, okay, at the total complexity. And another way to solve this problem, which is even faster, faster than gradient descent, is to do what is called the Newton algorithm. So gradient descent, you are only using your first order information about your function. You are only using your gradient. In Newton method, you will try to use the second order information about the function. You will use the Hessian. You will use some information about the curvature of your function. So how are you doing Newton? The idea of the Newton algorithm is really to look at the quadratic approximation of a function. You know that a function L will be not too far away of its quadratic approximation when you are using the Taylor approximation. So what is a quadratic approximation? That's my value at WT plus my gradient in WT transpose W minus WT plus my quadratic term, which depends on my issue. So you see that phi t of W, this is really the quadratic approximation of my function around the point WT. If W is equal to WT, this is exactly equal to L of WT. And what you can hope is that this quadratic approximation will not be too far away from the true function. In particular, if W is not too far away from WT, because you know that this will be the distance between the two will be of order W minus WT power three. Okay, you will have to go to Taylor at the order three. And so what you are doing when you are doing Newton, you say, okay, see, if this quadratic function is a good approximation of my function, I want to minimize L of W, but I don't know how to minimize L of W. It's too complicated. What I will do instead is that I will minimize my quadratic approximation. So you take a step, you're at your current iterator WT, you look at the quadratic approximation of your function around WT. This is a quadratic function. And you have seen with Martin that a quadratic function, you can minimize it in a closed form. So you can get a closed form formula for the minimizer of this quadratic function. So how you do so? You just compute the gradient, and you set the gradient to zero. This is a constant, so this will disappear. This is a linear term, so the gradient will only be equal to the gradient. Okay. This should be not the L curve. And then you look at the gradient of the quadratic part, and the gradient of the quadratic part is exactly equal to the Hessian times this. Okay? And so you see that if you set this is equal to zero, what you will directly get is that you take this term here, you inverse to remove this term, and you add WT. So what you will get, what is update of the Newton algorithm, it will be WT. You should not have some step size first, minus inverse of the Hessian times the gradient. So you see that it is very close to the gradient algorithm, but you are not directly following the gradient. You are following the gradient rescale by the second order geometry of your system. Okay, you are using the second order information of your problem in order to rescale the space, and you are not following negative gradient, but you are following inverse of the Hessian times the negative gradient. And in practice, what you will have to do is that you will have to add the step size, because if you are not adding some step size, then you are, it's not possible to prove the convergence. Okay, so it will not be difficult to, you will have some theoretical guarantee how to play with the step size. Do you have a question? Here? Yeah. I'm just plugging, what does it mean? This is my gradient of Vt in Wt plus one. I want that Wt plus one is the arg min of Vt, so I set my gradient to zero. Okay. So what it is possible to show is that the convergence of the Newton method will be very fast. Okay, it will be really faster than gradient descent. It will be what we are calling a super fast convergence. Okay, it will be more than exponentially fast. The problem of the Newton method and why it is not used a lot in practice is because gradient descent, I only have to compute my gradient. Newton method, I have either to inverse the Hessian, so that would cost you a lot. A better way to do it is just to solve this linear system. But you see that when you will use the Newton method, at each step you will have to solve a linear system. So the complexity often will be very large. It will be quadratic in D or even larger. So Newton method, you are using more information about your function. You are converging really faster, but each step will cost you a lot. And if D is large, it will be too expensive. So then there are some nice way to do Newton, such as quasi-Newton method. And if you are interested about this, you should follow our course about optimization in the second semester. Do you have a question? So solving this equation will guarantee you that in one step, you will have a minimum of the function phi t, which is a quadratic approximation of L. So each step of the Newton method is minimizing the quadratic approximation. It is not minimizing your initial function. Okay. So we will just, if you accord me two extra minutes, look at one important problem about what we saw today. It is in the case that when the data are linearly separable. So we talked about it last time. The case when you have some hyperplane which will cut your data in two. And what you can see is that in that case, if you look at your cost function for the logistic regression, and you look at the value in W bar, which corresponds to one of the separating hyperplane, and you take the scale of W to be very, very large, you can show that L of W will go to zero. Okay. So the problem is that, in fact, the minimum will not be attained. It will not be possible to exactly minimize the function. What you will have is that the infinitum of the cost function will be equal to zero. In order to go there, you will have to go in a direction to plus infinity. Okay, so the m value is not attained for a finite W. And so if you are using an optimization algorithm, it will never converge. You will just keep doing your optimization process, and your weight will just increase and increase and increase. So from an optimization point of view, it's not very good, because you will never know when to stop. And so often, to solve this problem, what you will do is that you will add some L2 regularization, as you have done in regression. You are considering your cost function for the logistic regression. And on top of it, you're adding some L2 regularization to penalize your weight, such that now when you will minimize this function, you have some L2 regularization, so you don't want to take W to be too large, okay? For a good parameter lambda, this minimum will be attained. So you will not have the problem of W going to infinity. And also from a statistical perspective, some sense this will avoid you to really go to this hyperplane, which is maybe not the one where you want to go. So this is a new parameter you can play with, and this is what is called the ridge logistic regression. Okay. A last comment to conclude today, which is kind of very interesting, is in fact, if you are doing stochastic gradient descent on this function, you will diverge to infinity, but you will go in a particular direction, okay? So you will go to a separating hyperplane. But what it is possible to show, and I left the link in the course note, it's possible to show that you will diverge, but you will converge in the direction of the max margin separating hyperplane we talked about Tuesday. So that is kind of funny about the algorithm, is that the algorithm will diverge, but will converge in one particular direction, which is a direction it could be interested to converge to. Okay, so that will be all for today. Thank you very much. And we see you each other Tuesday to talk about generalized linear models. Have a good weekend. Bye-bye.